Welcome friends to this holiday party. I am told that the holidays are celebrated with exchange of gifts. What gift can I give you except my love? All my love for you is my holiday gift for all of you. People exchange presents here. They give presents to each other. It's a great occasion for exchanging presents. And presents help also to clear our karma. Sometimes we feel we owe something to somebody, the time to pay off is in the holiday season. But some people have difficulty even in buying the presents. And they think it's a very big burden on them. I have met people who are very sad that we can't afford to give a gift. I want to remind them the gift of love, the gift of kindness, the gift of please saying nice words does not cost anything. And for a person who cannot afford, that gift is as valuable as a millionaire giving $1 million. There's no difference. I remember a story, historical story, of one of the Sikh gurus, one of the masters in that line, going to a particular village in order to give a discourse. In those days, people used to give donations for the work of the masters by bringing not only cash but also things in kind, wheat and rice and grains and things like that, so that they could be feeding the people who assembled for the master's meetings. So those donations were brought and placed before the master. There was one disciple of the master. He had no money at all. And he asked his wife, "Can you please scrape around somewhere and find some money?" And she said, "We have spent everything. I am sorry, at this time master happened to come at a time when we have nothing at all." He said, "Let us still scrape the floor with a brush or something and see if we can find." And they found one small coin, like a cent, like a penny. And he said, "I can't go empty-handed to the master. I'll carry this 1 cent." He was wearing a turban and he put that penny in his turban and he went to that meeting. And he sat at the back of the audience and he saw rich people bringing big gifts and placing in front of the master. And the master accepted them with thanks in a humble way. "I'm glad you brought this. This will be used for the meetings that we have here." Then they said, "Master, all the donations have come. Your discourse is over. Time for lunch." He said, "I am waiting for more donations." They said, "Master, all the people who brought their donations have already brought." The man sitting at the back said, "How can I go and present 1 penny? When people have brought such big gifts, what will I look like? What will the master think about me?" So he kept quiet sitting at the back. The master said, "I am waiting for more donations." And these attendants, these advisors, secretaries of the master said, "Master, all donations have been given what they brought. There is no more to be given." Master got up and he said, "Before I have lunch, I have to meet one more donor." And he walked through the audience and went to him. And he said, "You have brought a donation for me. Why don't you give it?" He said, "Master, I have nothing to give you. I have seen what people give you. And they are millionaires. They give a huge gift to you." And the master put his hand in his turban and pulled out the penny. He said, "This penny is worth more than $1 million. Because this is the only wealth you had. You gave all of it. Do not think that what you give as a gift is based upon the value of the gift. It's based upon what you can afford. It's based upon with what feelings you give. If you are giving gifts, 'Oh, I am under great pressure to give gifts,' What value do these gifts carry? We are creating a burden on somebody. When gifts are given freely, that's the best gift. So that is why gift giving is a good way to settle karmic accounts. But do not worry about matching the gift of somebody else has given. See what you can give and what you can afford. And gifts can be given at all times, but it becomes very nice to give it during the holiday season when we get together and we have an opportunity to celebrate a holiday. But those of us who are on spiritual path can celebrate the holiday in a little different way. How do masters celebrate their holiday? If we want to see how masters celebrate their holiday, there is one festival in India. They call it Diwali or Deepavali, a festival of lights. That is the most important Hindu festival in India. And most of the country lit up with lights and they celebrate and they have firecrackers and they distribute sweets and they exchange gifts. That's a big function. So one master from Agra, Swami Shivdayal Singh, says, Saints celebrate Diwali every day, every night when they are in a higher state of consciousness. If you want to, as followers of a spiritual path, as meditators, as those who have seen the inner self of yours, you want to celebrate a holiday, I can tell you the best place to celebrate is not in this physical world, but the inner worlds. Even in the first stage, which I was describing to you yesterday, that your inner self, which is you think is an imaginative self, which can fly, it can fly at high speeds. And I can tell you, if you want to try, fly with that and celebrate your holidays amongst the several galaxies that exist in this universe. And you will enjoy that holiday. Great vacation. You want to have a real good vacation? The best vacations are lying inside you. And try them out. So we are confined to a small place. When you enjoy those vacations inside, you will find that the body looks like a prison house. That's the very thing that confines you here, that you're not free. You have lost your freedom. This word freedom we talk about all the time. The real freedom is when you find that while sitting in this, you can also fly out and go out. Many messages come to us to save this prison house. But we ignore why we have started enjoying the prison itself. We started enjoying this cage in which we are caged. That is why it reminds me of the story of the Indian merchant who used to go to Africa for doing import and export business. The Indian merchant used to carry Indian silks and so on and went to Africa and brought nuts and cardamoms and things that they were growing in Africa at that time. So this was an exchange. During his visits to Africa, he used to pass through a jungle, a forest, which had many parrots flying there. So he loved those parrots, beautiful birds. So on one trip, he decided to bring one of the parrots with him back home. So he bought a cage and he took a parrot. There were so many of them. And he brought him home. And he fed the parrot every day with nice, beautiful food, parrot food. I don't know if you have any parrots, you know what their favorite food is. We call them those sharp chilies, which look very sharp to us, very spicy. Parrots love them. And then they love another food we call churi in India, which is just a mixture of butter and wheat and things, and we make a nice food. Parrots love that. He gave him the favorite food, churis and chilies, to the parrot. Told him how to sing, and the parrot was happy, enjoyed himself in the cage. Next year, when he was going back to Africa, he asked the parrot in his cage, "Mr. Parrot, I brought you from Africa. I am going to your country now. Do you have any message to send to the people back there?" The parrot said, "Certainly. Tell them I am enjoying myself. I eat nice churi and nice chilies, and I am dancing and singing all the time. I'm very happy in this cage in which I'm living here." So the merchant went back to Africa and he told the story in the parrots in the same forest, in the same jungle. He said, "I have brought a message. You remember I took one of you, one of the parrots, to India. that parrot has sent a message to you. He is enjoying himself in that cage, eating churi, and this is singing and dancing. On hearing this, one older looking parrot on a branch near him had tears in his eyes, and he fell down dead. So the merchant was very sad to see what kind of message I have conveyed to this parrot. He could not bear to hear it, and he has died. Anyway, he went back to India and told the parrot in the cage, "I conveyed your message to the parrots in the forest, but one forest must have been very close to you, an elderly parrot. When I told the story that you are enjoying your life in the cage, eating churi and eating chilies and having nice time singing and dancing, enjoying your life, that parrot had tears in his eyes and he just fell dead." Upon hearing this story, the parrot in the cage had tears in his eyes and felt dead. He said, "Oh, foolish merchant, if you knew this message was so powerful that the parrot in the forest died, how would you be able to save the parrot here by telling the same message?" He felt sorry and he opened the cage, threw the dead parrot out. As he did so, the parrot opened his wings and flew up and sat up on the wall. And the merchant said, "You aren't dead after all?" He said, "Nor is there other parrot dead who you met in the forest. He only sent me a message. If you want to escape from this cage, die while living." Also, one of the old parrot stories. I told this story at a Christmas holiday party when I first came to the United States. That happened in 1963. In 1963, a group of friends like you were sitting and I told this story. And they said, "We have to take you to a parrot jungle now and see if they can recognize you. You know this story so well." They took me to Florida. And there is a forest jungle. It used to be called forest jungle. Now they changed the name now. And the parrots there were trained to say different things. How are you? What are you doing? Where are you going? What's the hurry? They trained small words as you walked in the park and the parrots would speak. But they spoke in a parroty slang, you know, with a nasal voice. "What are you doing?" You know, something like that. I'm not really good parrot imitator. But when I was walking fast in those days, and the rest of the party was a little slow. And the other friends were walking slowly, chatting with each other. I walked a little fast, surprised at the training they had given to these parrots. And one parrot almost spoke up with a human voice, not the parroty voice. And he said, "What's the hurry?" I looked at him. I said, "No hurry." And he began to laugh. First time I saw a laughing parrot, and he put his head back. Ah! I also started laughing. When those people came and saw me talking to the parrot like that, they said, "Surely you were a parrot in your last life." And that Christmas they sent me a gift, a live parrot in a cage. I didn't know where to get the churi and chilies for the parrot. So I'm telling you a little history of this story I told you, that we have so many memories of these great times we have had on these holidays. And those holidays have given us time to think about what can we do if we want to have a real holiday, if we want to be really free, be like the parrot who was able to get out from the cage, who was able to fly. We don't have to die. We have to die while living. We have to maintain this cage and be in this body, and still we can be as good as dead and get the freedom what we will get when we die. We don't even know if we really get the freedom when we die, because we could be confined in another body. Another body made up of sense perceptions. And because we have created so many attachments here, those attachments pull us back into the cage again. The cages that we are enclosed in, which we call our human bodies, and I praised the human body so much yesterday. I'm telling you, it's a cage. It has usurped our freedom. We can't even fly with this. We have to use aeroplanes to fly. Imagine the capacity we have of going in time and space wherever we like. We can go back in space, back in time, forward in space, forward in time. All those capabilities are sitting right inside us right now. People want to say, oh, is the future predetermined? Why just ask a question? Why not go and check it out? This time frame we are looking at in the physical world is fixed already. As I mentioned yesterday, events which are happening later can be predicted earlier. Obviously, there's something already existing somewhere. Why not go and see it first? And this kind of time travel they are trying to achieve physically is possible for any individual working within themselves and going to the causal plane and discover the whole timeline and all the events already placed on it. Imagine the amount of access we have to real knowledge about time and space, about destiny, about our destinies, about how they are made, all lying within us and all achievable by simple methods of meditation, simple withdrawal of attention to your own self inside. This is not a religion. This is not something a particular society is advocating. It's a gift from nature. It's a gift from the Creator. The Creator has made the human body in such a form you have access to all of that. But don't get caught up only in the energy centers I described. Those are good for working in this world. Enjoy them. I can tell you, we did not come to this universe to suffer. We came to enjoy, to have an adventure, a temporary adventure before we go back home. Why have we got caught up? Just because we wanted to make it as real as possible. The features that are around in this universe are only designed to make it look more real, so we enjoy it more. Not that we get trapped into it. But somehow, the very reality of this experience is trapping us in, making us question even if there's any other reality or not, including the reality of our own self. What a strange situation that we have come for a temporary adventure, temporary experience, an experience generated from our consciousness, an experience experienced by our consciousness. Only if we are conscious, we can have an experience of anything. And that consciousness that is having, generating and experiencing this thing should be unknown to us, that we should not even know who we really are experiencing it. And we are so attached, involved and encumbered by the experience we are having outside, we lost sight of our own freedom. Real freedom comes the higher you go in the knowledge of your own self. The more you know your own self, the more free you will become. The ultimate freedom is when you are the creator, the witness of everything. And that's our reality. Our reality is that we are individual beings, born for a short time in a physical world. That's far, far away from the truth. The truth is we are the totality of consciousness, generating experiences, first of individuation, to make love into lover and beloved. To make love an experience. The individuation is not without purpose, not without any reason. The quality that exists in consciousness becomes an experience by creating the many out of the one. And not by separating them, just by creating the awareness of separation. Not real separation. We have never been really separated from our own truth. We have never been separated from the ultimate creative power. We have never been separated from God. We are always there. But the illusion was created simply for making the qualities of our consciousness into experiences. And the individuation was enlarged, made more effective by adding on some devices to it, like the mind, like sense perceptions, like body, like other qualities, like the nine people living in this body which I mentioned earlier. All these are added on to make the experience generated by consciousness more interesting, more adventurous, more to our liking. But try to make every experience more real than anything else. Therefore, we created illusions with our power of imagining, power of being conscious, just exercising our own identity as consciousness. If we say consciousness is our ultimate identity, what is consciousness? It is to be conscious of something, aware of something. If they are not aware of anything, you cease to exist. Therefore, consciousness continuously exists. If we can create time and talk of it in terms of time, it continually exists because outside of time, therefore it's continuous. Even in time, it's continuous. And therefore, consciousness operates by its very nature to be conscious of something. And whatever it is conscious of becomes creation. But it looks like it's just a reflection, it's just something being produced out of our own self. To make it real, to make the experience real, we separate it as an experience temporarily. That's what we have done. Not once, not twice, several times. Each layer makes it more vast in an expansive time and space. What a beautiful way to set up. If somebody were to ask me, can you set up a universe in a better way than this? My answer will be no, sorry. I've tried. This question was put to me by Great Master. When I told Great Master, couldn't God create a better universe? Couldn't God not have all the suffering in this world? Couldn't God have a universe with no hospitals and no prisons? I asked him this question. He says, everything created here has a purpose and it serves a purpose. And it is all designed to serve that multiple purposes that come up in this creation. And when you look at the higher purpose, you see exactly why everything has been designed the way it is and how it fits in. It looks terrible when you see a part of it. It will look grand if you see the whole of it. Have a look once, at least have one look from totality and see how these things have been placed. Imagine creating an illusion, an unreal thing, making it look like real, and then you come back to reality. Oh, it was just illusion. How effective is that? We're talking of suffering here. Suffering is created to enhance the value of pleasure and joyfulness. Everything is created in pairs of opposites. So when we see how beautifully it's created, look at it from the grand point of view of our own true self, totality of consciousness, oneness, only one. Even the word one is totally wrong. Why is it wrong? The moment I say one, you start thinking there could be two. The number is wrong itself. Even totality is wrong. There is no word to express our real self. There is nothing outside of our real self. It's all generated within it. This world is not created outside of ourselves. It is being experienced by us from inside. This world, sense perceptions are not creating a world outside, it's creating an experience inside of an outside world. The outside world is being experienced by us inside. The inner world is experienced by us inside, looks outside. Every creation in time and space looks outside but is actually being experienced inside. What is inside then? If everything we experience ever, at any time, at any moment, in any form, is being experienced inside, shouldn't we see what is inside? There is no experience that generated outside of ourselves, no matter what the form is. Here we have a form of a body. We see the world outside from inside this body. You have an imaginary self inside, and when it looks outside and imagines anything, it imagines from inside. If you go further inside, everything it experiences, creation of time and space from inside. You go higher, you find everything was inside. Inside what? Inside ourselves. That is why the power of our total real self is the secret that creates everything. You want to understand how such a variety of experiences can be generated? Look at the potential of the self. The real self is what we have given as the name of the ultimate creator, separating ourselves as if the creators are sitting somewhere else. How can when everything outside of ourselves is being experienced inside, how can there be creator outside of ourselves when we are experiencing here? Then we must be the creator of the creator. That is why it is clear that the creative power has always been inside. And we have to go within, more within, more within, to the source. And the source is so strange that what appeared to be outside was all happening inside. Nothing was happening outside. We say, this is a physical world. Just by division, just by creating layers, we are thinking there are several worlds. There is no several worlds. There is only one creator, create different experiences, and the experiences we call several worlds. It's our experience, which we call several worlds. But we think the world outside is real. We may or may not be, because the body we are wearing dies. Maybe the world doesn't die, we die, therefore the world is real, we are unreal. Identifying ourselves with the body does that. Identifying ourselves with any form of the form in which we are living gives us that feeling, outside is real, we are not because of the time frame. But the truth is that we are creating all this from within. Now, if that is true, and I know you can experience it and verify if it is true, that all levels of creation, all levels of universes we talk of, are all inside and have never been brought out except as experiences. If you understand that, we are living in our true home right now. We say we have to journey, how to go to our true home, how to meditate. What are we talking about? We are doing all that stuff in our true home. We never left it. We can't leave it. We can't be separated. We are total all the time. We merely narrowed our awareness of our own self, generated all these levels right in our true home. The spiritual journey is not a journey at all. It's an awakening, enlarging our awareness to our totality. Every level we go through will be found to be existing in the same place. That is why when we say we are making a journey and go within yourself and see your inner self, we think we have left this world, it is sitting outside, we are now seeing another world. No, we are just seeing that world. Then first we were seeing this world, then we see another world. And what happens if you go to totality? Do you see a separate home that where we left and came here? Not at all. We find all the creation of every level was in the same place. That is why a perfect living master who comes between us as an ordinary human being, what is his awareness? His awareness is of totality. That means he is aware of creation at all levels at the same time. He is awakened to every level, not he goes step by step to say, where am I now? We, as seekers, as those who are trying to discover totality within ourselves, we go stage by stage. When we reach totality, all stages are there at the same time. Now imagine, when we see a perfect living master, as an ordinary human being, and we look from his point of view, what is he seeing? He is seeing the physical form, he is seeing the physical world, he is seeing the astral world, he is seeing the causal world, he is seeing the soul, he is seeing totality, because all of this is in totality. Nothing is outside of it. That's one state where we all can reach, our own true self. If you reach there, will you be missing this? Some people talk to me like that. Oh, I have a lot of friends here, and what will they do in such cult, in true home? I'll miss all of them. I must tell you, all of us are there. All regions are there. Everything is right there. When you reach that level of total awareness, all the awarenesses come back at the same time. And not that right near in time and space, we as novices are trying to meditate and go from one state to another. When you reach there, all the states are available at the same time. Here we can do some physical work. Inside we can do different work. Mentally we do a separate work. What can we do if we are in totality? We can do all the work at every stage. We have the awareness of every body continuously. Not one and the other. We know we are wearing a physical body, we know the astral self, we know the causal self, we know the mind, we know the soul, we know totality. Imagine, this is what is always available to a perfect living master. That's the definition of a perfect living master, that he is in a state of perfection. That means way above the mind, which creates imperfection. So he is not only above the mind, he is also in the mind, in the astral self, in this thing. He is appearing to us as a physical being because he is also in the physical form. At the end of the journey, we discover that the master we see physically is merely an instrument, a representation of totality of our own consciousness. If there is only one consciousness, it's not two, it's not being shared by some people, it's not shared by anybody, it's only one. The generation of experiences makes us so many. That's a very useful experience. That's how we can experience love, we can experience relationships, we can experience highs and lows, we can experience a big ride into experience. It's been created so beautifully. And as you get enlarge your experience, you become more free. Real freedom, real total freedom comes when we have a totality of consciousness. Then you are totally free. You discover there is nobody else who existed except what we created. There is nobody else who has ever been there except what we are. We are all ultimately only one totality of consciousness. It's not merely a term I am using. It's an experience that can be had in the human body right here. Sitting six levels away from creative power that's come through different levels. Sitting in this level, alone in this level, specially generated. I heard people tell me, man is made in the image of God. That a human being is created in the same form as the Creator. Very interesting description. Does it mean the Creator also has a face like mine? Does he have eyes to see? Does he have a nose? Does he have a body? Obviously not. That's not the definition of God by any standard. We say God is omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent. We give him a very big definition. He knows everything. How can a simple being like us have these powers? It's not possible. What is the similarity? How can we say man is made in the image of God? When you study this carefully, what we are saying is that the power, the very great essential feature of the creative power we call God, is the power to freely create what he likes. True free will. That is what God has. That is what totality of consciousness. Total free will. Total freedom in any definition. That total free will is not represented anywhere in any experience except when you come down to a human being. Human being has the experience of free will. That's the similarity. That's the only similarity between a human being and the Creator. That is real free will. This is looks like free will. This experience of free will. That free will is with total awareness, total knowledge. This free will is with total ignorance. We are totally ignorant of the future, therefore we think we have free will. The day we find out that we can know the whole future, free will disappears. Therefore, when we get to stage one, we get more knowledge of the future, free will disappears. We go to stage two, it disappears completely. We are just robots going through a program, which has been made by us. Then we go higher, we discover that this was all a plan set up at a higher level. We go to the top, real free will. So the free will, which we talk about, big subject of discussion, occurs only at two levels. The ultimate totality has total free will, and this is an experience of free will because we don't know what has already been created in time and space. This ignorance is creating the free will, but very useful. Ignorance not to be blamed. Ignorance very good in this case. If there were no ignorance, you would have no free will and never have the experience called seeking. Seeking comes from free will. We want to seek the truth. We want to seek who we are. Where is seeking coming from? If there is no free will. Free will generates seeking. And seeking finds us the ultimate freedom of totality. It's such a beautiful path, I can't tell you. I tell you the best way to celebrate holidays to lock yourself in and meditate and find the truth. Instead of running around all over the world, the best is to meditate. Meditate more. I would suggest at least try to have a little better vacation during this holiday season of going something inside. And give away what you have. Take away my gifts. I want to get better gifts. They're lying inside me. These will not go with us. These gifts we collect, these little articles, physical articles we collect here, and we get so attached to them, they don't go with us. They are only meant for use by this body of ours. The body is not ours after a while, then what will these things do to us? So these things are not worth what we think they are worth. They are very temporary, useful things. Use them and forget that they are yours. They are not yours. They were never yours. You didn't own them when you were born. You won't own them when you die. So very temporary ownership, very temporary use of these things. Treat it like what they are. Just meant for use. Just meant for enjoying while you are here. And don't get attached. How does attachment come? Supposing I have some beautiful flowers. I look at them, I enjoy them. Good. I say, they are mine. There the problem arises. When we try to make things our own, then the ownership issue comes up, we are in trouble. Use of things is not creating any trouble. Nothing in the world is of any trouble. They are all useful, all good. Whether they are children, whether they are friends, whether they are objects, whether they are houses, cars, anything. They are all very good and useful. The moment you start saying, this is mine, trouble starts. Because only when you say, this is mine, an attachment can start. The attachment does not start without saying this. So when the mind says, it is mine, you get attached. Become more difficult to get out of here. Attachment brings us back because it's like seeking. Seeking the truth is taking you home. Desiring things here keeps you here. So that is why treat all these gifts that we have. They are abundant gifts. Who gave them to us? Who gave the biggest gift possible? The best gift possible of the human body? It's the greatest gift. And it's been given by a process that is existing of reproduction that's produced us here in this body and given the consciousness, given life by which we can have the best experience possible. What greater gift can you imagine? The gift of human life, the greatest gift possible, and we have it. How can you compare this gift with the smaller gift that we are receiving outside? So that is why make use of this best gift. Make use of the time available to us. Because time in this body is limited for every one of us. No matter how enlightened you are, time in this body is limited. So that is why make use of this best gift. Spend a little time during this holiday season in meditating and discovering the freedom inside you. My best wishes to all of you. My best wishes for you for the holidays. Best wishes to you for the new year. And they say 2020 will be great because everyone's vision will become 2020. I am very happy that you are all come to join me in this holiday. And some people want to sing songs and some people want to tell stories. You're most welcome to do that. So we now proceed with the holiday program and we'll have a little break.